There it is, one drop. Now I'm going to spend some time talking about that one. One of my favorite Christmas hymns, I think it's number 28 if you want to look at it, it's number 28 in your hymnal, was written in 1601. But it was originally written in Latin, and it was given a Latin title. I was kind of intrigued by the title. It was "With Sweet Shouting." Isn't that a great title for him? "With Sweet Shouting." And the great composer Johann Sebastian Bach liked it so much that he arranged it for the organ. And then John Mason Neal later standardized the hymn in English and changed the title from "With Sweet Shouting" to "Good Christian Men Rejoice." Ah, that's not politically correct, so the hymnal has changed it to "Good Christian Friends Rejoice." Now, the first stanza of that hymn, "Good Christian Men, Good Christian Friends Rejoice," tells us what every Christian seems to think about the Christmas story. I mean, it's a beautiful nativity scene that's described there. You have the baby Jesus who's placed in a manger, and he's there with his mom and dad in the stable. You got all the farm animals. It's a perfect crèche scene. Remember the words.
Tells us in one sentence why good Christian friends
should rejoice. It tells us of the great surprise the human race has received at Christmas. Indeed, I find that Christmas is a season of surprises. You know, I heard about this lady who was preparing Christmas cookies, and there was this knock at the door. And she went to the front door, she answered it, just to find a man who was thin, gaunt, and was wearing tattered clothes. She asked him what he wanted. He said, "Ma'am, I'm looking for some odd jobs, just so I could buy some Christmas gifts for my family this year. Do you have anything that I could do for you?" And the woman thought, well, and this brings back memories, Kath and I, we just painted our house. And she says, "Well, can you paint?" And he said, "Well, yes, in fact, I'm a pretty good painter." And she said, "Well, right behind me, there's 2 gallons of paint, there's a brush, and there's a, go out back, just paint the back porch. That's all that needs to be painted. And if you'll paint it and do a good job, I'll pay you $300. He says, "Well, that means so much to me. I'll do the job as quickly as I can." So she went to her, back to her cookie making, some time passed, and all of a sudden there's a knock at the door. She opened it, and it was obvious the man had done the painting. I mean, his clothes were just covered with paint. And so she said, "Well, did you finish the job?" He said, "Yes, ma'am." And he said, "Did you do a good job?" And he said, "Absolutely, ma'am." Doesn't even look the same. And she said, "Well, wonderful. Here's your $300, and have a Merry Christmas." Sorry to leave, but got to the door and turned back and said, "Lady, there is one thing I'd like to point out to you." "What's that?" He said, "That's not a Porsche back there, that's a Mercedes." Well, the greatest Christmas surprise of all is found in 2 Corinthians 8:9. "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that through his poverty you might become rich." Now that's the surprise of Christmas. Now, does it surprise you anymore? It should. So let's take a closer look with me. "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich." Did you know that Jesus was rich? I mean, he didn't look rich. He was always wearing those robes and sandals all the time. Yes, of course, when we think of rich, what do we think? We think of money, right? Money. Money, 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 money. And are you familiar with the address 220 Central Park South, New York City? Ever been there? That is where hedge funder Ken Griffin, back in September of this year, bought an 18,000 square foot condo. You know what he made? $200 million. And it's not even his primary residence. It's an investment, he says. Griffin has bought the most expensive house in Chicago, the most expensive house in Miami, the most expensive condo in New York, and they're not even his primary residence. That's rich. Don't you think? That's rich. But if I ask you, if you had $200 million, what would you do with it? See, there are several categories of riches. Yeah, there's the average. More money than most people, but not incredibly wealthy. Then there's the medium rich, your basic multimillionaire. And then you're super rich, if you remember that show, Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. Well, they were the super rich. And finally, there's the incredibly rich. That would be Ken Griffin and his buddies, the other basic billionaires in the world. Now, our text for this morning says that Jesus was rich. So in which one of those categories would you list Jesus? Well, none of them. None of them. Because the wealth that Paul is talking about here, that Jesus had, was not earthly wealth. It was his eternal wealth. You see, you really cannot appreciate that little baby in the manger on Christmas morn until you realize that before he was ever a babe in a manger, he was a king on a heavenly throne. Now, we spoke 2 weeks ago. I don't know if you can remember back 2 weeks ago. Before the Lord Jesus was born, we said that day, they lived in a place where the streets were paved with gold. The towering walls of the city were made of jasper. The gates were made of solid pearl. The 12 foundations of those gates glistened with priceless gems. Before Jesus came to this planet we call earth. He sat in splendor on a great white throne, while shining seraphim hung upon his every word. Legions of angels waited anxiously to do whatever he asked them to do. He not only controlled the universe, he created it and he owns it. The prophet Isaiah 9 verse 6, called him the mighty God. And I have to say, that was an understatement. When the baby Jesus was born in Bethlehem, this was not a new person coming into the world. This was the Creator himself, exiting heaven and entering our world. This was the incarnation. A couple weeks ago, we looked at Colossians chapter 1 and what it says about Jesus Christ. Christ existed with his Father long before he ever came to the womb of his mother on earth. There was never a time when he did not exist. Because he is God, he is self-existent. He needs nothing from us. He is self-sufficient, and you and I are dependent upon him. See, more than just a baby in a manger, Jesus Christ, as we said 2 weeks ago, is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And 2 weeks ago, we looked specifically at Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. Remember? For by him all things were created in heaven and things on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. So that little boy, baby boy born in Bethlehem, who grew up in Nazareth, could point to the hundreds of billions of galaxies out there, the hundreds of billions of stars. He could point to the sun. He could point to the moon. He could point to every square foot of this planet we call Earth. He could point to every person who has ever lived. You know what he could say? Mine. And how do you measure then the worth of heaven? How do you measure the worth of omnipotence where you can do anything? How can you measure the worth of omniscience where you know everything? How can you measure the worth of omnipresence where you are everywhere? You see, Jesus was rich. Rich. He was a king whose rule was unquestioned, unparalleled, and unending. He never knew a moment when praise, honor, glory, adoration did not exalt his very presence. Because he is the God of glory. And because he came to this earth, we can actually imagine the glory of God. Jesus was rich. But Paul continued. Even though our Lord Jesus was rich, immensely rich, infinitely rich, immeasurably rich, we are told, yet for your sakes and my sake, he became poor. Now what exactly does that mean? When did Jesus become poor? How did he do it? Well, I believe that that question is answered for us by Paul in Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, he was rich, did not consider equality with God something to hold on to, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a servant, coming in the likeness of human beings. Again, this is a reference to the incarnation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Some people think the greatest miracle is the resurrection. And in fact, I really kind of lean that way. I think the greatest miracle is the resurrection. And yet, if I'm open-minded, it could be that the greatest miracle of all is actually the incarnation. You know, without the incarnation, there would be no resurrection. I mean, if God could come out of heaven and live an earthly life, surely he could come out of a grave and conquer an earthly death. But here is the mind-blowing thought. To think that God would become a man is something that is still unfathomable. It is one thing for dust to become deity, but for deity to become dust, that's a whole other thing altogether. Many people would like to be God, but imagine God wanting to become like us. That's a surprise. Yet that is exactly what happened. And notice the verb in our text this morning from 2 Corinthians 8:9. It says, he became poor. Not that he was made poor. I mean, that's what happens to us. Our situations in life cause us to lose money and we become poor. But Christ himself, of his own free will, became poor. And that's something that we would never do. He voluntarily gave up the riches of heaven for the poverty of earth. He was the richest being that has ever been. And he gave up freely and became poorer than any person has ever been. Now, would Ken Griffin, our billionaire, that we and other billionaires do that? I think not. We understand riches, and we understand poverty. But to choose poverty is beyond us and something we would never do. But that is at the heart of the gospel. The richest being in the universe, of his own free will, became poorer than the poor. The Reverend James Merritt, and I really admire him, reminds us that the Lord Jesus, who created everything while he was in heaven before he came to earth in the incarnation, when he came here, owned absolutely nothing on earth. This is what Merritt says. He was born in a borrowed womb. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. To pay taxes, he had to borrow money from a fish. To feed 5,000 people, he had to borrow lunch from a boy. To have his last meal, he had to borrow an upper room. To ride into Jerusalem for his own crucifixion, he had to go on a borrowed donkey. Christ became poor for us all. There was no room at his birth. There was no home in his life. There was no grave at his death. He said the foxes have holes and the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. You talk about living below the poverty level. That is exactly what the Lord Jesus Christ did for us. He became poor for our sakes. Now, why would you do that? Well, the answer is found in the text. It was a generous act, or what I'd like to say, it was a gracious act. God's infinite grace was that he came to earth to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. And in this one verse, we have the prosperity of Jesus right alongside the poverty of Jesus. The Christmas story, not of rags to riches, but of riches to rags. He went from the sovereign to the servant. He went from being a king on a throne to a criminal on a cross. But what was the purpose of his poverty? Why did this rich God become a poor human being? That you, this is what Paul says, that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Wow. And now we're going to get down to what it really means to be rich. I mean, listen carefully. At this Advent time of the year, true riches cannot be bought with a credit card, a debit card, a check, or cash. You can never enjoy things that money can buy unless you possess things that money cannot buy. Let me tell you why good Christian people rejoice at Christmas. Because they understand how rich they really are. Do you understand as a Christian how rich you are? A Christian is someone who is in Christ and has Christ in him or her. Our Heavenly Father once looked upon our Lord Jesus Christ at Christ's baptism. Remember what God the Father said of his Son, Jesus Christ? He said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." He had a wonderful, perfect relationship, Son with Father, Father with Son. Now think about this. If God is satisfied with his Son, and if I am in Christ, and Christ is in me, then God must be satisfied with me. I have a righteous, perfect relationship with God. And if you are in Christ, and he is in you, then God must also be satisfied with you. Do you know what that means? We no longer have to live under the demanding enslavement of working, begging, pleading, fearing, bargaining, or doing so many good works that we can never imagine to find favor with God. Which is what every other religion in the world teaches. No, because of our relationship with Jesus Christ, Christ is in us as we put our faith in Christ. Wow, we are in perfect relationship with God. Not some future time, but today, right now. In the Lord Jesus Christ, you and I are just as safe and secure as Jesus is standing before God. You are not only rich in who you are, but you are rich in what you can do. I mean, think about this. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You have a power in you that is more explosive than dynamite, more powerful than TNT, and greater than all the atomic energy in the world. You have within you, as a Christian, a sin-killing, devil-defeating, soul-purifying, heavenly-charged power that nothing or no one can ever defeat. I know many of us have been doing our Christmas shopping. Yet Black Friday, yet Cyber Monday. Well, the truth is, you do not give Christmas meaning by either giving or receiving gifts primarily, but by receiving the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ, into your life so you can have a right relationship with God from now through all eternity. When you receive Jesus Christ into your life, you receive the greatest gift of all, which is an unhindered relationship with God, which will last forever. You remember the last stanza of that Christmas carol we began singing at the beginning of the sermon? Let's sing that. Christian friends, rejoice. Amen?
Amen.